Thank you, Your Honor. This is the last. Mr. Vice Chairman, I ask you a question, and you are going to make a question. Do you want to complete your last question?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, just to Mr. Bowen, but I'm trying to establish that the former Iraqi electricity minister was accused of corruption of potentially landing millions of dollars. He was arrested, he was brought to the green zone. I believe he was in the DOD facility.
After I graduated from the Judicial Institute, he did not consider me as a member of the prosecution, but he dealt with me as a regular employee.
Thank you.
Thank you. that we demonstrate to you in front of you that the private asked for a conducted investigation action, the presidency, the Council of Foreign Ministers, current and former ministers.
Yeah.
But I asked that one, which is screen the press might
be a copy of it.
And the document says that the al-Radhi, because the wording is so small, it's been decided not to refer any of the following parties to the court. And the report of His Excellency, the Prime Minister, has obtained presidential office, Council of Ministers, current and previous ministers. This is a secret order from Prime Minister Maliki's office saying that you cannot investigate the Iraqi president, the Prime Minister, any current or past Iraqi ministers without the Prime Minister's position. Is that right? And we have a copy of it here. Close your language of it. And you're not in there, that's right. Is this all right allowed under the Iraqi Constitution? Against the Constitution, and the Constitution considers the CPI an independent entity, and that would only be subject to the orders of the Parliament.
Thank you. Judge, did you have any cases that you were investigating that were stopped by this order?
Of cases were stopped because the inspector would go to the courts and the courts would stop looking into examining the cases.
But did you have cases that involved current and past ministers?
Yes, current and former ministers.
I would say that this letter, this secret letter, in a sense, it demonstrates to me that there are violations of your own constitution going on under this administration.
That's true.
And to me, I interpret it as corruption.
Yes.
But this is a new developing democracy. We need to attack corruption wherever we find it. That's the reason for this hearing today. I appreciate your response, and then you want to translate that. I appreciate one of your responses to one of our members when you said corruption is corruption. And I'm a professional, and I go after corruption wherever it may be.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your testimony. I hope that it falls in my time to check.
Thank you very much, Mr. Watson. Now we have to talk to Mr. Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for having me, sir, and I appreciate the program, particularly with Judge Ryan. This member is a famous man. Sectarianism and corruption are pervasive in the Ministry of Interior and cripple the Ministry's ability to accomplish its mission to provide and counter security of Iraqi citizens. Things are apparently so bad in the Interior Ministry that this report by General James, Supreme Court General,
Thank you.
Assessing the state of Iraqi corruption, not as an appropriate topic for oversight and review, because it amounts to economic undermining of this fledgling democracy. Corruption is the abuse of public office for private gain. It is a common large family. I quite appreciate that. The question really isn't to be vandalized, but the question is, what do we do about it after we look around this mess that it was rampant under Saddam, it was rampant under Maliki, and then in fact, it goes far, far, far down. It doesn't flow just to the top the way it once did when it was. It really stole with the permission of the top. You have the fiefdoms that are stealing on the line. I guess one of my questions, has the GAO ever investigated another sovereign nation's utilization of these resources?
Well, the only thing that would be close is if the Coalition for Freedom of Authority was set up by the United States, the Coalition for Freedom of Authority had access to both U.S. funds as well as Iraqi funds.
And you oversaw, or your organization oversaw, how we spent their funds when we were in control.
Actually, what we did was we were involved in the expenditure of U.S. funds. Facilitated the release of records from the U.S. government to the Board of Surveillance of Iraq so that they could hopefully do the audit work with regard to Iraqi funds. So we have not audited Iraqi funds, but we facilitated the Board of Surveillance with being able to do the same.
So we're not going to be complete on one thing. I know you're not going to find one person on the bench under any circumstances is satisfied with the level of integrity, transparency, or a lack of corruption in Iraq. That's something that, from the chairman going both directions on the dais, it's very clear that this is not a government that works to the best interest of their people, particularly if they're seen as an ally or current in the north. Mr. Bowen, in your written testimony, states the number of corruption cases under investigation in by the Iraq Commission on Public Integrity was 1,861 in 2006 and 3,158 in 2007. Can you describe essentially how we got to this increase? It looks good on paper. Tell me about it.
Look, what we see more than is an increased effort under Judge Rada's leadership to push forward, try to push back the tide of corruption that has been rising. It's just testified today. It's also indicative of that rising tide itself that the corruption efforts have increased. Because the work is to be done.
Right. And I appreciate that. Just to your knowledge, how many convictions have there been in Iraq?
I don't know what the total number is. There have been hundreds of convictions.
Okay, so there have been convictions. And yes, it's typical penalty.
It depends on the nature of the crime, of course. The challenge in Iraq, especially with the ministries, is that there is selective prosecution because there is by fiat the authority within the ministry to protect any ministry employee from any corruption investigation. And so I'm aware of some cases wherein most of the defendants were protected in Iraq by 36B, but one of the lower level ones was permitted to be prosecuted in a prison because of their sectarian identity.
I was pleased your boss said this is a way to work.
Judge, one question I have for you is, when did you decide that you needed to leave Iraq and get your family out of Iraq to a permanent place such as the United States for safety?
contractors and officials to the parliament about this issue of threats. And then they start repeating my residents with missiles, then it has become very difficult for me. $18 billion total amount, only half a billion is related to issues pertaining to the Ministry of Oil.
Thank you.
start that the Ministry of War effectively financing terrorism through these relations. Can you tell us what you mean by that? Are you saying that the Ministry of War is related directly to the terrorists?
Yes, such as the invasion in the central part of Iraq, there are Sunni militias that control this region, and they take a great share of these revenues, and they use some of the imams to finance their militias. And the same thing goes to Basra, where the region is under the control of the Shia militias.
Can you point to the nation where the real progress has been made to provide the corruption that you're talking about?
As I said, in my testimony, that the government closed many cases and intervened in our matters, and it goes against the Constitution. That was the thing that impeded complete good results. States is dedicating a lot of money,
aspect of this will be that surrender letter progress much in a positive direction.
For what you've seen.
Well, for several reasons, and one of which there's been a great climate outside of the country to provide the security situation. The question is whether or not it's still got that big of a reverse, and I think it's going to take a more stable security situation for that to be reversed in a significant numbers. Secondly, they have the de-identification policy. And if political progress can be made on that, such that there might be a possibility to be able to tap some extra keys from the former regime, and then have quote unquote the battles that might hard.
First off, some employment issue that we are problem in Iraq is unemployment, which ranges up to 40% by some estimates, and that provides a great ground for insurgent recruitment with respect to the corruption effort and the attempt to stem the tide. We've issued two audits in the last 13 months that have found that the U.S. effort has not been well planned, well coordinated, or well funded. That notwithstanding that we created two-thirds of the anti-corruption bulwark, the IJs and CPA, I spent a good portion of the first third of my time in this job taking on the support of the IJs because of the backing and support. I pushed for an anti-corruption summit, which the U.S. recalls had about in November 2005. But notwithstanding those efforts, the plan, the coordination, the funding, never came about. Unfortunately, it's disappointing that it's coming.
We were trying to try and resolve the room. In fact, the witnesses are just right. I made a time that the judge made, which was to suggest that the infrastructure in Iraq is almost equal to zero, and that the services, key services being provided by ministries in Iraq are almost equal to zero. Zero, which I think is a very damning assessment of what we've seen.
Thank you, Mr. Sorbonne. Mr. Phillips.
Well, I'm disgusted that anybody got to do that because I came in a little later and I didn't have to go away before. How many more do you need? I've been having to wait for one more.
First, Judge al-Radhi, I want to say to you that you honor us by your presence. You are a very brave and distinguished man. We have known about you for a number of years, and I try to get to Iraq every 3 to 4 months. So to have you here is a real honor. I would like to say your decision to leave Iraq is understandable, but it is a huge defeat for good government and my hope of success in Iraq. And I'm very sorry that it's come to a point where you feel you need to leave. I first want to say to you, Mr. Walker, I get concerned when we from the outside look in here to Mr. Bowen. From the outside looking in, are passing judgment on circumstances that I think are known, and yet there's recognizably very little solution. I mean, one solution is to give up on Iraq because it's correct. That's one solution. And I don't think you're suggesting that. No one can blame the U.S. government for the fact that the Iraqi government is corrupt. No one. You could blame us for going in. And let me just ask you, Judge al-Radhi, are you regretful that Saddam's regime was overthrown by the United States government?
As I said in my opening statements, I thank the United States and the State to have moved
So it is important for people to know, as I see all the time when I go into Iraq, thank you for coming. Now, I'm getting ready to go. What do you think the biggest mistake was that the American government made?
That's one. The second thing is that the Americans helped the Iraqi people by removing the dictatorship. And what is happening now in Iraq is really the work of the neighboring countries. The aspirations of the neighboring countries. Regional aspirations.
Should we give up on Iraq?
Regional aspirations.
Thank you. I want to ask the judge, should we give up on Iraq?
The people would hope that you continue your support to them, otherwise they would be suppressed by the neighboring countries.
So, appreciate the fact that the United States can and we don't need to sell, and you do not want us to leave. So tell me the bottom line issue of what we can learn by your testimony. That will help make Iraq a better place. I cannot have your testimony be used by some as an argument that we should leave.
In reality, it's a great endeavor. You came to Iraq and to liberate the liberation of the great empire. And I believe if you help the Iraqi people to be managed and governed by the honest government, I believe that the problem will be over.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sharish. I'd like to thank all the witnesses, and I'd like to pursue for a minute the issue that Karen had mentioned regarding the efforts of the administration to muzzle any discussion about corruption in Iraq. And I could ask Mr. Walker, Mr. Bowen, Mr. Walker knows I was a journalist in the former life in his life, but the first thing I was personally interested in efforts to consume information, natural resistance to that. Last week, the State Department informed this committee that their officials would not be allowed to provide information about corruption in Iraq unless the committee agreed to treat it as classified and withheld it from the public. The State Department sent an email to committee staff confirming that virtually any discussion of Iraqi corruption was not classified. Let me show you what the State Department said was classified. And that said, valid statements or assessments which judge or characterize the quality of Iraqi governance, or the ability of the determination of the Iraqi government to deal with corruption, including allegations that investigations were thwarted or stifled for political reasons, and statements or allegations concerning actions by specific individuals such as the Prime Minister or other GOI officials, or regarding investigations of such officials. Mr. Bowen, let me ask you first, is there anything that you said today that will pass muster or according to this directive of the Big Order?
It's a pretty broad directive. It does not apply to me or my testimony today.
Senate did apply to you and your testimony. But in fact, without that one, what you could do? Would you be able to be your wife to be this policy on your quiet day?
If testifying for his committee, I would have to be more circumspect about what I said. But if everything I've said today, virtually everything I said today, we've reported on in the past. And so I'm wrong. This is not new news. We first called the President of Corruption in Iraq and Second Insurgency Group a year ago.
Now, Mr. Lockett, did you know that the State Department would consider the broad statement in your report that characterized the ability of the Iraqi government to deal with corruption? Corruption would be classified information.
No, that's not what happens in my first. My testimony is based on this report, which the State Department had an opportunity to review and comment on. And they did not classify the information in this report, which is the basis for the testimony. Secondly, I can understand why the State Department might have a concern if you were talking about specific individuals, because frankly, in our country, we would probably have some concern about testifying with regard to ongoing investigations dealing with specific projects. With regard to the broader challenge itself, I think it would be worth mentioning you're trying to classify discussions about the broader moral challenge.
I was going to ask you that the report that you submitted would have the State Department would use it this way, but the time approval would be classified by the guidelines.
Well, we did submit it to them. I don't know for time, which we know in general expected to have the lines to use, and secondly, also for sensitivity review, classification review of it. What you have before you is unclassified.
As part of this new classification policy, the State Department also went back and retroactively classified the reports issued by the Office of Accountability and Transparency. I understand that both GAO and the Special Inspector General received copies of these reports. When they were classified, did anyone ever tell you that these reports were classified before you received them?
There's two circumstances within the last 2 months where both the State Department, this man, and the Defense Department, if they've been retroactively classified something, they've been made available publicly, and in some cases around the worldwide world, which is obviously, I think, highly questionable.
Thank you very much. It's pretty obvious, Mr. Chairman, that we all know what's going on here. There's no real danger to national security from these reports. State Department was fine with circulating on an unclassified basis throughout the government and wasn't before this committee. As to see the documents that they took this action, so it's pretty clear that the administration just wants to muzzle any comments that are threatened negatively on the matter of the government.
Well, do we have to do that for this, Mr. Chairman? We have to ask one of the people at the State Department whether we agree with the statement by Secretary Rice when she praised Mr. Maliki for his efforts to stop corruption, she didn't praise him. And we asked this from the State Department, would you agree with that? And he said, I'm not allowed to discuss that in the open forum. I can't believe the attitude that the State Department has taken in this regard. It's just incomprehensible to me whether I do that, whether I do that. It's just a horizon for the Congress of the United States to be able to get information about corruption. And the Iraqi government, the only excuse is that it might embarrass the Iraqi government. Well, I think that the information is already on the record, public knowledge, and it should be a source of embarrassment to the Iraqi government, a source of concern to the U.S. government. The levels of corruption, according to General Marco and Special Inspector General Bowen and Judge Radhi, is that corruption is increasing in Iraq. The State Department can't keep us from knowing that. They can't censor that just because they think it might embarrass and wear our relationship with the Iraqi government. Too many Americans are really fighting and dying. Too much Americans are paying taxes to support the efforts in Iraq. We want to pretend something that's not happening when we all know it is happening. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, thank you for that. I testify that corruption is a serious problem for Iraq, and it is, but I can't attest as to whether or not it's increasing or decreasing based upon our work.
Well, let's say you would do
it. Mr. Chairman, I'm not going to be clear for the record. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You should cover yourself.
Mr. Bowen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Locke, it's good to see you again. Do you have any ulterior motive for being here today?
For several years, she investigated thousands of cases involving Shia, Sunni, and Kurds, and by being so persistent in advocating, you made both friends and enemies. We've talked with many people in the U.S. government who are very proud to be associated with you. For example, Christopher Griffith is a senior advisor to the U.S. Office of Accountability and Transparency at the U.S. Embassy in Iraq, and he said this about you, quote, "I think he's the most honest government of Iraq official that I've met in my 21 months in the country. He has never lied to me. He has tried to be studiously non-sectarian in his efforts, and I have worked closely with him. And to the extent that I would trust a government of Iraqi official, I would trust him." Judge Arthur Brennan, who is the director of the Office of Accountability and Transparency in the Enemy, said this about me, quote, "Among the people that I've worked with in the U.S. Embassy, Judge Roddy had a reputation as a courageous, honest, and effective, and at least as effective as you could be under the circumstances, as effective director of CPI. And of course, you know Mr. Bowen is sitting next to you today. When you resigned your position last month because of escalating death threats against you and your family, Mr. Bowen stated, quote, 'It's a real blow to anti-corruption efforts in Iraq. He was the most prominent corruption enforcer.' Mr. Bowen, do you stand by that statement today?" Yes, I do. Last month, you were attacked by the Iraqi government. Mr. Bowen, from what you know about Judge Roddy, has worked in Iraq on these very important anti-corruption issues. Do you believe there was any merit to those accusations? So I found that Judge Roddy made my most reliable partner in carrying out my mission in Iraq. Accusations are commonplace within the Iraqi government. Judge Roddy, I just want to join the rest of the committee in thanking you for making the difficult journey here to share your important testimony with us. No one here understands what you've been through as a truly courageous person standing up for truth, standing up for justice, and we appreciate your efforts and thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I want to ask you now to consent that the documents that were referred to in question, which both
I'm going to be very brief. My first round, but it's a way to people yell to you. It seems like you've been here forever. I just want to follow up on a question that I asked earlier. I asked the question for a reason. We are putting in $6 billion a month into Iraq. Round and narrow, it's greater, it's less, it's huge. Is that huge amount of money approaching $1 trillion that's been spent in this theater so far? Why wouldn't we treat Mrs. Iraq, Director Walker first, and thank you, Mr. Bowen, why wouldn't we treat Iraq oversight of their corruption and of their use of their funds as we treated the Marcos government, as we dealt with the post Soviet Russian period, as we've dealt with Colombia and other countries in which drug money has had an adverse influence? Why wouldn't this committee look at it in terms of the leverage of U.S. money? And I ask that because although I don't believe we've yet made the case, I hope by the time we join in a few minutes that we will have made the case, that in fact this committee, in both an unclassified and with comments and budgets, hopefully in a classified setting, should be learning much more than any one individual can tell us. I've got a general offer first. In your opinion, your experience, is it appropriate for us to have oversight over the billions of dollars being spent of U.S. dollars and not see the effects of the other dollars? Because I would presume that for every dollar that we don't spend, the Iraqis would have to find a way to come up in many cases with those dollars. And for every dollar we contribute, we believe their obligation to use our own money wisely.
Sustain that darkness or hurts of children, either through effective strategic planning and appropriate funding. The way I did, implicit in operation on that front, and that is engaging those with expertise on the issues related to international corruption and the fight against it. And that's the work I gave to people in Iraq right now, and everything in August. They put ideas and no capacity themselves to address the issue, they need to lean forward and deploy. To engage, is to be aggressive ultimately, as with everything in Iraq, multilateralizing a solution will improve the likelihood of success of this flexible democracy. Thank you, Judge. Just in closing, I want to thank you for your courageous work over the last several years. Hopefully, you understand that even though tough questions are always asked by this Congress, it is with great appreciation for the work that you have done in Iraq on behalf of your country and your Baptist Church.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Participation. We have votes on the last floor. We are starting last minute, so we'll be back in 10 minutes because we still have the Ambassador Larry Butler from the State Department and Ms. Claudia Rosett. And from the foundation requested by the Larry Butler East. So we're staying in recess to respond to the votes, which I think should be back in 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Just to
It's undermining Iraqi confidence in their own government. It's funding the insurgency and its fostering sectarian divisions. All of those are major questions when it comes to what's going on in the Iraqi government and the state of corruption that's taking place. I believe it's essential for Congress and the American people to understand the extent of corruption in Iraq and its impact on foreign policy. Our committee staff tried to ask the State Department officials about the corruption issue, but the State Department refused to allow them to provide any answers unless the committee agreed that all answers would be considered classified information and not discussed in public. We're going to read through some of the questions we tried to ask. I think some folk, who's a senior consultant to the Office of Accountability and Transparency in the Office, we asked him what effect does corruption have on the progress of the Iraqi government and their ability to work for a call for reconciliation. He was instructed that he could not answer this question in an open forum. We asked him whether Prime Minister Maliki or his associates obstructed any anti-corruption investigations in Iraq to protect his political allies. He said, "I cannot answer that question in an open forum." And other State Department officials were also expected not to answer questions about whether the Iraqi government has the political will to root out corruption or whether corruption is funding the insurgency. That's a rhythm in democracy. Our system of government depends upon any foreign public. What would be the rationale for preventing these officials from answering the committee's questions in a public forum?
Mr. Chairman, service employee at the State Department in that annual evaluation is required to evaluate his or her performance and protect the sensitive national security information system.
I understand that. Is that sensitive national security information to which the questions are taught by just recording the answers?
We had earlier today, Mr. Chairman, graphic testimony from Judge Riley about the risks. Very much based on the price that he and his associates paid in Iraq and pursuing and attempting to deal with the corruption that exists in Iraq. The programs that we have contain some elements which are national sensitive ones based some of the Iraq rationale.
We're not asking specific questions, we're asking general questions. And what I understand is that. Is that the State Department people told us that the various questions that were critical of the Maliki government were undermined our relationship with them and therefore in the contrary of foreign policy interest. Does that make it possible?
It very much falls under one of the provisions of the executive order that provides a basis for classification, which is where some revelation of information would damage bilateral relationships that is intended to be kept confidential.
Mr. Chairman, let me ask you some of these questions. You can tell me if this is something that you think has to be kept confidential. Has Prime Minister Maliki or his associates instructed any anti-corruption investigations in Iraq to protect this political allies?
I would be unable to answer that question in a classified setting, Mr. Chairman.
And why is that?
It's just to the nature of our relationship with the government of Prime Minister Maliki, and we have repeatedly, on many occasions, turned back to the committee to staff to provide answers to questions like this.
How can you say whether the government of Iraq currently has a political will or the capability to provide corruption within its government? I believe that the government of Iraq has that will.
I'm in a position to detail any of the anti-corruption efforts undertaken by the government of Prime Minister Maliki.
That's not the previous question I asked. Do you believe that the government of Iraq currently has a political will or the capability to provide corruption within its government? How are we going to have any chance of success if there's corruption going on in the Maliki government? If I, as a representative for over 600,000 people in Canada, this committee asked you from the State Department whether you have a chance to succeed
situation so that they can revise it quicker. Do you feel that you have the right to say that you want to answer this question?
My experience with 31 years of data in the Soviet Union and the laws of the future responding is that this is incredibly hard to address and be able to respond to that question in appropriate circumstances.
Do you think that would be the appropriate financial regulation to finance the war for the Iraq war? It's an Iraqi government that is it's best to stop corruption.
About the direction improvement we're dropping off in the level of transparency and work
Commission must be agreed on a need for reform, such as carbon sharing, such as these corruption laws. To the extent that they're on the agenda, you get no points. Do you see the white people in any timely fashion that are going to be passed and enforced? I want your opinion, your assessment of that. So-called benchmark legislation, which doesn't include anti-corruption or measures specific to the federal working with Congressman Radhi continues to work towards achieving the legislative goals. In the meantime, the thing I'd like to point out there is that Congressman Radhi did something back in March, which dramatically improved one aspect where there had been corruption. He put the Iraqi army around the Beijing refinery. He started watching the refinery specifically, which was literally going out the front and back there. And as it happened to black market, the second thing the Prime Minister did, and it's an important point, was following IMF recommendation to on two occasions decrease the price of fuel in Iraq, which reduced the disparity between the black market price and the street price, which is taken as a dividend to land on the black market. Some of that money was going into criminal networks, some of it was going into the insurgency. These are very important steps to drain the swamp of insurgents and organized crime and identity. So, my story has expired, but I can just add those plenty of things about it, but you can't connect it with the evidence. Mr. Chairman, we acknowledge there is corruption in Iraq, corruption by necessity, as Mr. Pryor's work on the defenses of the other Iraq destruction. We recognize that this is a rapidly changing environment, and we have an embassy which is rapidly changing and evolving to meet and respond to the threat, if you would.
So, I'm talking about what you were able to say in this meeting. You're able to say all the things that you think are positive at this time, but you're not able to talk about the failures of the Iraqi government. You don't have power, given us very clear indication with this. Why can you talk about the positive things about the manufacturing? We have a little picture.
Mr. Chairman, you have to answer those questions in an appropriate setting.
An appropriate setting for positive things is like the question you had. But the same thing, why did it have to be behind closed doors?
I discussed the issue about the environment of diplomatic relations and national security. Is there a building to
close the line of propaganda?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Stuart Bowen. I'm with David Walker, testified on the division about the lack of leadership undermining the anti-corruption efforts of the U.S. Embassy in Iraq. Mr. Bowen, Mr. Walker are certainly not alone in that sentiment. And as I sit here, I've been there on the field at the post, and any area of corruption, I reported to the Secretary of State immediately. So on my watch, I would not allow it to go on with the police making a statement about it. And I would go any place at any time to say that Americans' taxpayers' money was being abused and misused. So over the past few weeks, many staff have interviewed several embassy officials involved with U.S. Embassy anti-corruption efforts. And they uniformly told us that no single official has been put in charge of U.S. efforts to combat Iraqi corruption, and that there is no coordinated strategy for fighting corruption in Iraq. Judge Arthur Brennan, who served as the director of the Office of Accountability and Transparency for part of 2007, was asked whether there was an overall U.S. strategy for combating Iraqi corruption. Let me read an excerpt from this transcript. During the time you were there, were you aware of any coordinated U.S. strategy to fight corruption in Iraq? The answer was no. James Zantel, who is a law coordinator at the U.S. Embassy, told committee, says the following. The embassy over time developed what are called stove-like institutions. There is no coordination, as I have said before.
you have a system where the coordination is lacking. Anti-corruption efforts are supposed to be a cornerstone of the United States effort to bring political reconciliation in Iraq and as if possible.
Something different because we have a password problem, we might say that we gave it to
Since the basis of the problem of corruption in Iraq is market distortions, cultural dominance, intimidation of officials, undeveloped civic culture, lack of government capacity. What market distortions enable the most positive corruption?
First and foremost, when you're selling subsidies in the marketplace here, we sometimes feel that this is going to be diverted out of the marketplace into the hands of officials and organized crime networks who are selling it. Thank you.
assessment. That comment has long set the office that has the authority and responsibility for oversight and to ensure the following anti-corruption efforts are focused on a common goal. But while the efforts are being performed in an efficient manner, I haven't seen that the office of accountability has only had one permanent director, Judge Brown, and he lasted a month. He was doing a good job, but again, he's only there for a month. Now, I know that the Inspector General, Stuart Bowen, had recommended that the appointed senior leader for the prominent state to run the office, and yet, we have evidence that actually, by default, some paralegal is great, but not good to run this critical industry. There's a lot of testimony there that you know, I could have made a mark, to be honest with you. And when we ask you about the level of corruption here, we're getting answers like, we don't want to talk about any broad statements or assessments to judge the level of corruption in Iraq. $450 billion over the next 5 years. How does that square with you know, your constitutional responsibility and ours? The embassy, the U.S. government has invested heavily in the last couple of years in broad-based anti-corruption efforts. The first instance is the plenty of life that Saudi Arabia wanted to develop capacities and ministries, and more recently through the creation of infrastructure teams. Let's talk about that. You tell me, you got this refusal there to testify in detail about the level of corruption in Iraq and what was going on. How do you reassure us, your Congress, representing the American people, they're looking for more money over there, and yet you won't even tell us about what you have found in terms of the level of corruption and whether the unity is better or worse over there? Details that the first panel talked about. I mean, how does that square? We have a problem here. We have a problem with constitutional dimensions here. Now, I respect the job that you do, we all do. And it appears that you don't have the same respect for the job that Congress must do. We have an oversight responsibility. We have to sign a blank check to find out how progress is being made in terms of the resources that we've committed to this. Congressman, two things. One, we have provided to the committee all the documents from the embassy that we were able to find related to corruption. Besides, we've made it clear that we're prepared to answer your questions in an appropriate setting. But we're prepared to do it today.
This is a matter of transparency. Do you see the irony here? You've actually established the committee on accountability and transparency for the benefit of the Iraqi people. And yet here, when we ask you to exercise the same transparency with respect to your responsibility to the American people, you're claiming that there's a level of confidentiality that's required that we can't actually tell the American people, the American taxpayer, what we're doing with their money. It's just ironic that you're standing there. And I know it's not your decision, sir. This decision was made at the Secretariat level. Let's be frank. And I know you're just doing your job. But it's totally disrespectful to the American people.
Mr. Congressman, the issues and the aspects of the fight against corruption in Iraq. Most people's lives. We were talking to Judge Radhi earlier today, what has happened to him and to his colleagues. It takes that danger.
Thank you.
somehow we didn't have to see that quickly. More focused on this issue. I think it's a constructive part of this hearing to ask for. Mr. Axton, thank you for helping to focus attention on that issue. If it's decided that people in Iraq, the government is correct to give it 35 years of support, but that the Iraqi military would be different now than the government to which I might add is concerned that we might pull the right out from under them and that they may not even exist. May I ask them, Mr. Shanks, I think this is an appropriate question. Has Prime Minister Maliki or his associates instructed any anti-corruption investigations in Iraq to protect his political allies? Do you think that's an appropriate question? Of course, Steve. Is there anything that you would think that I would think it was appropriate? Well, Ambassador Butler, would you please answer? Question. Do you believe that the government of Iraq currently has the political will or the capability to root out corruption within its government?
Do you think that's a legitimate question?
I would hope that the ambassador would share with us his sense of rightness. Would you like to?
Mr. Chairman, we provide an assessment of the compensatory points of the government's efforts on anti-corruption. Messages coming to transmit back to Ambassador Crawford,
System of coordination lag, and by the mention the executive secretary of the anti-corruption work group suggested it might be able to say that they've done quite a bit in this area, but unfortunately, they're not. That's important. The state of consulting the Office of Accountability and Transparency was the primary driver of two reports issued by the LFA in December 2006 and another in July 2007. Those reports assessed the anti-corruption efforts of the Iraqi government, something that built out of the military security and rescue. According to them, these reports were not classified when they were drafted. They were not classified when they were issued. They were statewide, sensitive, but unclassified. Both Chris McGriffith, senior vice to the IT, Judge Arthur Brennan, the former director of the IT, as I said, confirmed that those reports were not classified when they were issued, and they were not classified when they were drawn. Are you aware of those reports? Mr. President, I am aware of those reports. I have only 5 minutes, and I don't know what else is wanted. In the last couple of weeks, we've become aware of working documents prepared by our IT. We're aware that these reports were not classified when they were drafted and issued by the Office of Accountability and Transparency. We only found out 2 weeks ago these documents, working documents, even existed. Did they become
currently on police committee might be asked for those reports to be given to the committee for this investigation. Mr. Bowen, that first case, maybe not a lot of the prosecution we did before. So why is it that when we ask for these documents, Mr. Bowen is only asked to review the documents for prosecution when he has no experience in that field work?
Oversight that the State Department was providing with regard to Blackwater and troops and their private military. Now I'm wondering what kind of job the State Department is really doing with this conflicting testimony and oversight in terms of anti-corruption efforts. I think this is going to be a serious matter that we're going to have to review. I also wanted to say that I'm sorry, I think your position. is actually absurd. But the Taliban can answer questions that are not put forward, that the Iraqi people are entitled to have answered before they're appropriated more money to put into this war that they're doing in Iraq. I just cannot understand it. So, when I say we're going to have a confrontation with the Secretary, we will end up in the State Department's doing its job of oversight. With the private military, is that they've employed, whether they're doing a job of oversight with regard to anti-corruption efforts, which our emphasis should be supporting more strenuously. And we heard about why the State Department's refusing to talk to Congress. It never answers the questions that ought to be given in the public forum. So, I put that out there to address the human addressing point.
Thank you.
witness refused to welcome Claudia Rosett, a journalist in residence at the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies. We're pleased to have you with us today. It's the question of this committee to invite those four witnesses to answer questions that we asked you today. You are sorry for your answer to the questions, so truthfully,
thank you very much for the chance to testify here today. I hope I can give some welcome writing, some background and context for what you have been discussing. These are extremely important matters. It's the right thing at the distance here. I'm listening to other few things I want to mention because I think they might be important. I cannot agree with you that corruption is a huge problem. And it's one that should concern whatever side of the aisle, whatever. A brief story I want to tell you. I worked in Russia in the 1990s, and I was the most popular chief for the Wall Street Journal. I required there before that. And there were no laws at that point. The Soviet Union had just collapsed, and very much of what applied anywhere except corruption was the way. Anything that worked worked for corruption. And there came this problem called the Iranians down the hall who were trying to make the fuse box work again, and then another final story that couldn't get anywhere. Finally, the military investigation was prison. I called a man who wanted a Nobel Prize in Economics for looking at the interaction between political institutions and economies, exactly the nexus where corruption takes place. His name is Douglas North, back in the States. And I said, how long is it going to take for them to sort out the institutions? Was wrong. So what is that over 50 years? I thought, oh my gosh, that's I think the real time horizon. And if I could just suggest, and I don't know what I want to get to is Iraq was immensely corrupt before the period that we've been discussing and the time when Saddam was there, and it's terribly important in understanding how to address this. I don't think anybody here who praised the judge and understands that some of the problems there wants to simply leave it. But to understand the matters fairly, there are different kinds of corruption. And it's something that's extremely complicated to clean up. I've seen it in countries in the Far East, in the former Soviet Union, and I've spent the past 5 years looking at how it worked with Saddam Hussein was in Iraq, because it was until the new time of the United Nations on the Freedom Program, which I reporting on. Corruption is something that comes to sort of improve as it becomes more democratic, but it's an organic process. It's not something that you can sort of do it step by step. And it's also not a finding of agencies. There is a tremendous effort in the process of getting rid of bad rules. It's the difference between, say, a Bangladesh with very high tariffs, which they even just normal with like second sentence, can be illegal and corrupt, and Hong Kong, where it's a free market and it's a legitimate trade. And there's not such a reason for officials to have their hand on it. Anytime you see these levels of corruption, as you do in Iraq, and up for a long time, that's part of a political problem. Further, I think this needs consideration. This can be discussed and explained in many ways, but corruption does not necessarily bring down governments. That may be unfortunate, but it did in fact bring down the transparency of the national lines list just now. And in my written testimony, you mentioned that the Iraq is built from the bottom, but they're bunched up a great many countries way down near the bottom on the scale of 1 to 9. agency that I grew up is one second. But the way that it works, that enormous corruption that is highlighted by the regime, it doesn't necessarily follow in that way. That's not one can deploy and what countries on this list sort of very close to this level of corruption can sound like Russia, Syria, Azerbaijan, Belarus, where the dictators have been in power for years, Venezuela, and so forth. So, just to say, this is a complex scene, and in the short time here, it is like something important to understand in Iraq. Under Saddam Hussein, it was immensely institutionalized. Corruption was so much part of the government that it had one of the fascinating scenes in a federal trial that just concluded with the guilty plea in Iraq and London. Was an Iraqi witness who ran the corruption database for the oil ministry and the hundreds of millions of dollars of kickbacks that poured in when Saddam began collecting kickbacks on all of their contracts. They actually set up officially inside their state marketing organization an entire section database cabinets of employees who did nothing but track graft. And this really was graft. It had to come through some companies, and it was something that violated the agreements that Iraq had struck with the United Nations. It was also graft in the sense that it was skimmed away from money that was supposed to go for the relief of the Iraqi people. It went its status with them for policies, weapons, conventional, but still dealing with, and all the other things that Saddam Hussein wanted to deal with. When his government fell, in a sense, the same kind of thing happened in the former Soviet Union. This corruption was, in a sense, privatized. There was no longer sort of the state under Saddam was Saddam. So when he decided to have a corruption for kickbacks, as the judge said, oil was for Saddam and his back. That oil was the main source of, that was almost the only source of foreign exchange for Iraq.
Is it fair to say that when you had the words that maybe Saddam was saying corruption was centralized and that would be the start of the network, that corruption spread much further to others that could be corrupted independently?
It was spread even at that point in the sense that oil was for Saddam, but there's huge evidence, documentary evidence, and I've looked at it, it's publicly available for many of the investigations into the environmental food program. But the ministries, some of the ones that you're also concerned with, the Ministry for Sports, or if you run through the list, the ministries, many of them, which were involved in the humanitarian contracts, also had kickback deals. And so it was institutionalized there as well. What has been inherited by the Iraqis, I mean, everyone who is dealing with this right now, the Americans, anybody, is a system in which really every part of the system is reflecting how something like this going on. The evidence I have seen suggests that Saddam had a very, very organized way of breaking in the oil, grabbed up the money. The rest of it was more difficult for him to control. In fact, I read a testimony, I mentioned the press report put out on the subject in 2002, even before his fall, by the Coalition for International Justice, which talks about the United Crusade, remember that, the Hussein rockets, and they were jockeying, sort of like the supply base of Iraq, before who would control the Turkish Republic.
So, what is it that the fact that the corruption that we're seeing now in Iraq is making it harder for the Iraqi government to reconcile the different ethnic groups, the Shiites, the Sunnis, the Kurds, and the fact that the corruption that's going on now is making it more difficult for the Iraqi government to have legitimacy with the people of Iraq?
I think that it would be a wonderful thing if the connections were that linear. And that's what I'm trying to explain it, because it's a more complex set of interactions.
And this is one of the factors that works against the goals of reconciliation in America and the
Simply on the outside of the draft, and the that program would have become the Iraqi economy.
There's no problem in Iraq to try to figure out how to deal with the sharing of the global revenues because it's so much making part of the economy. So the Iraqi government is trying to push them to adopt legislation for more sharing of the revenues of the poor of the Iraqi state and the future of the country.
I don't think you get my own perspective. Many people and many things are thinking about how this problem. I would actually say part of it, a big part of the problem with corruption is a symptom. We are not going to try an economic, just an economic slam on this. Corruption is basically what is a corrupt deal? There are many kinds of ways and levels in which you can engage in it, but basically, it's putting the price on the transaction. Say you want something done, okay, I can get that done for you. I have discretionary power, but there's a price. That's a pricing mechanism for things that, in a society with life, with integrity, ought to just let the government treat and if that's for you, not that you pay for it. And in that sense, is one of the things that is makes for immense corruption as long as it's in the raised by that to the people who are in that would be the what that does is it removes from the public domain that endless tempting pot, which I actually think is expensive right to have the war that's going on there right now.
We also know that the two branches of our issue right where the lights are on the show. Come on, Mr. Davis, to ask you a question. Well, thank you very much for sharing your insights on this. Iraq, right now, is a fledgling democracy.
In a normal economy, they would tend to make it worse because they would put on the government employee regulations and match them. But Iraq hasn't had a normal economy since eight decades. I think the problem of how people choose to spend their money, this may sound odd, but I just, again, I'm sort of thinking, the economic view of this, can I just suggest? We've heard a lot from the State Department today and from bureaucrats who use phrases like capacity building. I don't think anyone who uses the phrase capacity building is going to be able to think past that garden to figure out what really needs to be done.
What do you think the State Department is doing enough?
Sorry?
Do you think the State Department is doing enough?
I think they're doing so much so that they're doing a lot of things. They're doing too much of what they shouldn't do, not enough of what they should. And I think what they ought to be doing is, first of all, to whatever extent they can, looking for ways to reduce all these mechanisms and make it possible for people to collect graft. What is it that people are selling when they collect graft, when corruption happens in Iraq? Oil is one of the things that fuels it. That's what I was going to say. I think flip around, as long as there's oil in the public domain, it will be extremely difficult to deal with corruption. And that's the reason, if you look at the OPEC lineup, with the exception basically of Norway, there are enormous influence states.
Well, that's because the democracies in Norway have to face the contract between big debts for services and get the money because the money's coming to us.
That's exactly right. And when you have to try to align with the people you have collected the taxes from, you have a great deal more. Take a country. It's started in Russia, it's started in Venezuela, it's started in Russia, it's no accident. Yeah. I mean,
the State Department ought to be different than the State Department.
Some of the most perceptive actions that to me when I was working there. That is one of the problems here. And in other words, we are so tempted to talk about body corruption in terms of the sound of an agency in a study. There are things that, if we had privatized that oil when I first went in there, I could see the complications that there would be. It's quite dark, and you can see what's in here, and it's extremely hard to bring into being. As the best I answered 50 years when I was young, it wasn't true. But back up for a minute, looking at the countries, look at what was going on in Europe just after World War II. Germany was a disaster. I mean, God gave me one of the laws about how corrupt things were in those times. That was the third one of our surveillance, so I can't get past certain male waiting children. Just saying, one thing I think is terrible in terms of the context, and it is that there is more corruption in Iraq than there was, say, during the final years of the Saddam. Because I think he asked a further question, corruption at what time? Like, why is it buying? What's it doing? But basically, what I'm saying is, oh, yeah. I think they should have exposed the documentation they had on corruption under the Iraqi program. I think they should have sent out documents as soon as they went into Baghdad and began fighting for other scientists. I think they should be producing more today.
But obviously, this is the regime of Saddam Hussein, so the capital of the regime, the regime with the criticisms, but the way that they have the most constant dialogue.
Yeah, we have one more thing. But the frustrations that you are experiencing, I thought I'd trying to get back to
the table. We did it there.
State Department, the U.S. government had been, forthcoming at the time, had been open, had said, here are the documents showing what's going on, who's doing these deals. I think that would have actually possibly even put it off this war. Okay, that's how what you think it was, but I agree, it should happen now. I would link that to something very important. As an argument for science, the bomb in Iraq, to me, it doesn't hold up, because what is it we're trying to achieve there? You know, would it be then less correct if we were right? I don't think so. I think the damage I've put it very well. I think predatory leaders would move in, and it would be beyond anything we're seeing now. Should America care about that? That's a subject for another hearing, I think.
But you would say, yeah, you would agree with that. You would agree with that. The failure of the State Department to publicly address this issue makes it easier for it to continue. In other words, if you want to shine a light on this problem and publicly address the problem, you're more likely to be able to solve.
Yes, I agree. I can see a case for how the output is probably the 2 or 3% of whatever the actual documentation or evidence is that does in fact involve mortal danger to somebody. I'm all for that. But the other 80 or 90% or something, yeah, we have there in our mind. I think there's over and over again, we see with diplomatic institutions, I see this all the time, quite a focus in recent years has been the United Nations. State Department is in some way put to that kind of thing. We see the argument that we can't block the mess of shit people. We don't want to disturb anything. Very often people are not fools. Iraqi sounds are corrupt. There's corruption. It has real effects. It's better to say there is the problem. And if that needs to be accompanied for purposes of U.S. politics or security, it's terribly important that we be able to sustain a government in Iraq one way or another. Fine, but yeah, better to tell the truth.
Is it safe to say that the State Department worked for robotic corruption in Iraq? People in Iraq are still going to know whether there's corruption in Iraq.
Of course. I don't want to go into the subject.
Are you
the danger here is that you can start selectively targeting people who may want to play on it. But I think it's not necessarily that I can't make a policy that is against the right way to talk about Iraq, but it's not going to be wrong. What it seems to me is when we see a corrupt act, when we see a bail off, when we see this, we expose the act, not that many people go to see who performed the act. And it seems to me that that should be our emphasis. We're not doing a very specific action of corruption. And I do agree, Mr. Chairman, at this point, I totally agree with it. If we have a witness that says Mr. Malachi or someone else, and he was able to open the door, saying to us, very specific person, I'm basically talking if I did this, my life would be in danger. Now, if he's saying that someone else is going to make your life in danger, that's one thing, but if he's saying, I'm going to make sure your life's in danger, I think that's as far as I do.
The gentleman here from the council, I'm going to ask Judge Radhi, he says that Prime Minister Iraqi is corrupt. He said to me, I'm a judge, I can't make a decision. Of some of his
relatives. And frankly, that I think is the key point. It's kind of what I'm learning from this. The way he said it is the way I think we all concluded on it. Because he is basically stating fact and action to which we then can respond, which is the basis of law, actually. I thought the state statement was excellent because the one thing it's done for me is it's made me realize that there are no corruptions in lots of governments. But what you think about this is, Mr. Bowen, he was actually teaching the citizens to be corrupt so that we could have the power to do it. And that was great.
May I just share with you for a second? I was with the other day, and we've got a short business plan at the same time, so maybe you could get together with Mr. Chief after the
This is what you see from the New York courtroom. It was simply the silver laptop. I read an article about it in the Wall Street Journal yesterday. You can read it, but the silver laptop on which the entire kickback database for the Iraqi army is found, and all of the data that they downloaded this database, and this Iraqi witness stand brought in by federal prosecutors to show the jury how it worked, typing in the name and the point. A whole list of unlawful kickbacks and connected front companies, and I have followed these documents for years at this point, but I've never understood quite that viscerally until I saw this, how thoroughly institutionalized it was. It was the
branch of this
was the order of the film, and at this point it was a document since I didn't
get the council message.
Thank you very much, Andy. Thank you.
I appreciate that story.
And I think these have been revealed by both the Democrats and the